Oh, good morning, Christian Unified. All right, did y'all have a good week? You had a nice little time off, spring break. If it was good, give me two claps. Man, if the person beside you is not awake yet, give me two claps. If you think ASB will get here by the time chapel starts, give me three claps. Oh, man, I don't know. Hey, we have our representatives, though. You guys just take notes for them. You know, you gotta worship 10 times as hard. I just like picking on ASB. I love them. Tell them I love them. Don't let them be like, oh, Grant doesn't like us. Man, if y'all are ready for worship, go ahead and stand up. If somebody beside you is seated, say, slap them. Give them a little slap, slap. Tell them to get ready for worship. Not a hard slap. I just heard it in the back, man. Not like that. I just heard like a pop. That was your best friend, huh? Man. Hey, I got an announcement for y'all before we get into worship. Hey, if you're with me, say yeah. Oh, he's with me. I know all year y'all are led in worship by the worship team up here on Patriot Praise. If anybody is interested in joining Patriot Praise, tryouts are going on, or auditions, or whatever they're called. But where is Rachel Prelako? Right there. You can come and talk with her. So if y'all are interested in learning how to lead worship, she can help you with it. If that sounds good, give me one big thumb up. There you go. All right. Y'all ready to worship? Hey, I can't hear you. Are you ready to worship? Okay, we have some middle schoolers that are ready to worship. High school, are you going to worship God this morning? They say, yeah, man. Oh, y'all better get ready. Let's pray. God, we love you so much. Father, as we look around in our lives, it's so clear that you're making a way for us. God, that you provide for us, that you have a plan for us. Even the fact that we have a place to be this morning. God, as everybody walks in here, we've got a place to sit. And if we're not here, we're missed. If we're not here, somebody's asking questions about us. God, because you have people in our lives that care about our spiritual well-being. God, you have people in our lives that want to challenge us to worship you. God, you've surrounded us with teachers and faculty and staff and all these people that want to push us to have this relationship with you, knowing that it's what we were designed for and created for. And there's no greater life than one that's lived for you and with you. So God, would you help us to do that right now? During this next hour, help us to live our lives completely for you. Help us to worship you completely. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, everybody. Let's worship together.
Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my
loyalty. Who would care that much about me? Let me tell you about my Jesus. As we're going into this chapel, I really want to encourage you to have the mindset of giving it all to Jesus. I know everything is kind of crazy. It's the end of the year, and it's hard, and it's stressful with all the essays and everything that we've got. But to know that God is still with us and that he can give us peace is something that I really want to focus on. So Matthew 11:28 says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." So let's sing this next song together. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for every person in this room. Help them to know that they are loved and that they are appreciated here. Lord, please bless each individual and help them to go out through their week with joy and peace. Lord, thank you so much for our chapel speaker and that we get to worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Fear is the source of most of your sins and struggles. How to overcome what I want to call misplaced fear. Everyone in here will deal with some type of fear. Notice I'm calling it overcoming, but it's overcoming misplaced fear. Because there's a right kind of fear to have, but there's also a wrong kind of fear to have. And if you don't learn to deal with fear, it's going to cause you all kinds of trauma and strongholds and issues in your life. I'm telling you now, you better learn to deal with it now. When you're this age.
Oh, you excited for next week or what? Man. Hey, I know you guys had a week off last week, and I know every time we come in here, we've got an opportunity to learn more about what God has for us. So I want to challenge y'all to lean in for the next 40 minutes. Are you with me on that? We didn't have anybody lean in. Y'all ready to lean in? Lean in like you're ready to lean in. There it is. Josh is about to share with us. Josh Straub is a husband, he's a father, he's very passionate about helping people find their identity in Christ, not just on the field, not just on the stage, but in the home. I know y'all have experienced that before. Well, maybe you excel in the classroom, maybe you excel in the field, maybe you excel in all kinds of different ways. Well, one of the things that Josh is passionate about is helping us find our identity, not just in our skills, but in our Creator and what we were designed for. So y'all please give Josh Straub a big Christian Unify welcome.
It's an honor to be here. I want to start by introducing myself a little bit and talking to you a little bit about myself when I was just ready to enter into high school. So this was me in middle school right here. There we go. Oh, I have to push the button. Wrong one. There we go. There we go. That was me. So, hey, what are you guys laughing for? Hey, anybody with a mullet in here right now? Because mullets are cool. Like, mullets are back. What I didn't realize is that I wasn't actually that cool. Can you put that picture back up there, please? So, oh, there it is right there. Wow, that's a big Josh. You know, when I first got this picture, I was sharing it with my with a group of youth pastors, and I called my mom. I said, Mom, can you find that really ugly picture of me in sixth grade? And she said, Josh, you were never ugly. Look, that's a face only a mother could love right there, okay? And so I showed it to one of my buddies. He says, whoa, what happened to you? I said, I had laser eye surgery. He's like, did you have laser face surgery too? Jeez, please, right? My mom said, you just tell him you hadn't grown into your teeth yet. So this was me in sixth grade. And I was also the smallest in sixth grade. I was the smallest in my class. And I had to overcome a lot. So what I did in my early years to overcome being the smallest in class, being made fun of, is I started wrestling. And wrestling became an identity for me. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that today, how I started to cover up who I was by entering into sports. This next picture is my family today. This is my wife, Christy. We have a 9-year-old Landon, a 7-year-old Kennedy, and then our little Micah will be 2 next month. So this is my family. This is my pride and joy. This is a lot of what we do together. My wife and I have an organization called Famous at Home. Thank you. We have an organization called Famous at Home where we help people be famous at home so they can thrive on their stage. But ultimately, we care about making sure we live that message as well. And so you'll hear a little bit about that today and why we're so passionate about that. But as we get started, I want to help you understand that we're talking today about becoming emotionally mature and the power of becoming emotionally mature, because I genuinely believe that emotional and spiritual maturity go hand in hand. You cannot be spiritually mature and remain emotionally immature. And at this age, to understand that is so powerful and it's so important. And I want to connect it to why I started wrestling, how I started to cover up my true self and my identity to find who I was and what I did and where I got recognition. And I didn't even realize how that was starting to really play itself out until I hit my adult years, when we were married, we were doing fairly well. I have a counseling degree. We felt like we were set until our greatest opponent came into our marriage weighing 8 pounds and 1 ounce. So this was an image of us early on with our firstborn Landon, who's now 9. We were struggling as young parents. Like, we were really, really struggling. And I had been, my PhD's in counseling, I'd been working with juvenile delinquents and troubled families for a number of years, and I wanted to find out why it was so difficult. Because as a parent, you can't, there's so much that's being thrown at us to tell us about how to raise kids. So I just want to give grace to parents in here today and give grace to your parents. Because you can't, I mean, you think about the decisions that we have to make about whether we spank or not spank, about whether we breastfeed or bottle feed, whether or not we do time ins or time outs, BPA-free products, gluten-free diets. Like, there's so much stress and fear coming at us as parents that what we end up doing is we start to parent out of our parental fears. We start to react to the fear in our lives. And I wanted to go back and I wanted to think about, in these early years of parenting, I started to think, like, is parenting really this difficult? Like, why does it seem so difficult, and could it be simpler? Not that it would be easy to raise kids, but could it be simpler? And I went through the research and I started to look at, where do I desire my kids to be? And I'm going to tie this to you here in just a second. What do I desire? Every major outcome that I want for my kids, yes, to get good grades, yes, to do well in athletics, yes, to do well in extracurricular activities. And by the way, can we just give an honor and a praise to the worship team up here and how amazing they are? Can we just honor them? Thank you for that. Man, it just blessed my soul today to experience worship. So I was like, how do I, and then ultimately, like, for you to get married, for you to stay married and actually enjoy your marriage, for you to find a career that you love, that you thrive in, and for you to have, like, to raise my kids to have a faith that sticks. And as I went into the research, what I found is that every single outcome came back to this one primary factor, and that was this thing called emotional safety. That when we experience an emotionally safe home, if I created an emotionally safe home where my children could calm their fears, calm their overwhelm, that it was linked to all these major outcomes in life. And I started to realize this, and I started to go, wow, well, then that means that I, as a parent, it really matters to me about how I'm experiencing the love of God for me, how I'm experiencing my own emotional growth, my own spiritual growth, and how I'm engaging that. But the reality is there's so many fears that the outside world is trying to get me to think about how I'm raising my kids, because they want me to buy their product. Right? They want me to just buy the next product on the shelf. And so fear continues to be overwhelming in our lives. I want you to think about this. Look at this quote. It was a quote by a journalist in 1964 by a guy named Eric Severide. And he said this. He said, the biggest big business in America is not steel, automobiles, or television. It is the manufacture, refinement, and distribution of anxiety. There is no more, this quote is more real today than it was in 1964. Because I want you to think about how you engage social media if you're on social media. I want you to think about how you engage the next picture that you're posting. How you look to other people. The fear of am I looking good? Are people going to approve of me? Am I going to get likes? Am I going to get followers? Am I going to, and then to buy the next nicest thing on the shelf. The next, you know, the Apple products or whatever products are coming. It's like, I got to go get the next best thing. It's like, we're driven by fear about who we spend time with, how much money we have. And what we do is we start chasing. We start chasing in life. And this idea of emotional safety for me really came, and this is how it applies to you today, when I started to look at students and I started to look at outcomes of jobs and who we want to be in life. And a few years ago, Google did a major study. They did a major study of their hiring process. And they wanted to find out, is our hiring process actually working? And what they found was that they took the most productive teams within Google, and they started to look at the most productive teams. And what they found was that of the most, because they were hiring for STEM skills, so they were hiring for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, all the hard skills, that's what they were hiring for. And what they found of their most productive teams within Google is that those skills were coming in dead last. What they were actually hiring for was coming in dead last. What do you think might have been coming in at the top of the most productive teams within Google? The skills that mattered most. Number three was emotional intelligence. Number two was empathy. And number one was this thing called emotional safety. And so Google and all these other tech companies started changing their hiring process to start hiring for character, for our ability to show up well with other people, our ability to be truly present, our ability to step into the shoes of another and have empathy. And so as you think about what you want to do in life and who you're becoming and what you want to be and do, think about this idea of emotional safety, because for us in our parenting, it really was a wake-up call. I studied this stuff. I studied it up here, y'all. Like, I knew this stuff. But until that first baby came into my life and started screaming and didn't allow me to sleep at all and started causing tension between my wife and I because we weren't sleeping and we had all this stuff going on, really, that's where I started to realize the power of being emotionally safe for other people, but how that applied to me first. And so today, I want you to think about this in relation to your own life. Because when you bounce around and you, because what happens is, and this goes back to this manufacture and distribution of fear in our lives. You see, the world that we live in pushes us to answer the question of fear by putting our identity in what other people think of us, or who we associate with, or how much money we make. And when we do this, our emotions ebb and flow based on our fears. A fear of how others see us, how smart we are, whether or not we're smart enough, whether or not we're pretty enough, whether or not we're going to be alone for the rest of our lives, right? The feeling of aloneness. And our feelings will ebb and flow. And what we'll do is we'll make decisions out of this. Because when we allow our emotions to dictate our identity, we start to put our identity in things that start to give us significance. For me, it was wrestling. It was baseball. I started to find significance in sports and having an identity in those places. It might be that you're seeking a boyfriend or a girlfriend or a significant other in some way because you're afraid of being alone. Or it might be that this, the number of TikTok views that you have or followers that you have on Instagram or whatever it might be. I want you to think about what you chase to find significance. Because we all have a chase. In a fallen world, every single one of us is chasing something to feel approval in our lives around us. And what ends up happening is our emotions, we do this off of our emotions. We ebb and flow off of our emotions. And so emotion, let me just describe real quickly what emotional immaturity looks like. Emotional immaturity is when we act on our emotions. It's when we're feeling something and we react or we act on that. Or it's the opposite of that, at the other extreme, we don't feel the emotion. We either deny it, we suppress it, or we repress it, and we pretend that it isn't there. And so we just become like robots in life. I want to give you today what I believe emotional maturity looks like in a way that you'll be able to leave here and you'll go, oh, this is how I can gauge whether or not I'm growing in emotional and spiritual maturity or whether I'm not. And then what I want to do is I want to walk through five brief ways that you can build emotional maturity in your life from a biblically based perspective. And I believe that there's one phrase that will help us begin to see how we can live emotionally mature. And this comes from a book that I've recently read that I just think it's helped me to find my true self, to be who I am, to embrace. Doesn't matter if I was the smallest kid in the class, I'm going to embrace that. I'm going to embrace who I am in Christ. I'm going to be okay with that. I'm not going to, you know, ebb and flow with what other people think of me. I'm going to do everything I can to constantly be walking in Christ. As Paul said, I die daily in 1 Corinthians 15. I'm dying every day to my identity in Christ. And this one phrase, I believe, is a phrase, it's a litmus test for all of us for how we grow in emotional maturity. And that, and this comes out of Brennan Manning's book, Abba's Child, in chapter 2. It was just this one phrase that I looked at and I was like, oh my goodness, that's it right there. Here's the phrase. Do you show up in a room shouting, when you walk into a room, do you show up in a room going, here I am, here I am, look at me. Or are you showing up in a room saying, oh, there you are. Now, you might not walk into a room going, hey, here I am, but I want you to think about a room right now. I want you to think about a room that you're in. I want you to think about maybe it was a birthday party or some friends, or you were having a pool party, whatever it is. You're in a room and you know the people who are, by their behavior, by their actions, by what they're saying, by what they're doing, you know they're going, here I am, look at me. They're trying to butt into a conversation. They're trying to, you know, talk about who they are, what they do, who they're connected with, right? And anybody, raise your hand if you can think of a situation where you've been in a room where you're like, oh yeah, that person was trying to be here I am. Raise your hand if you can think of that person. Yeah, I think we all can. Now let me ask a very humbling question. How many of you have been that person? Okay, we're gonna have confession after this, okay? And we're gonna meet with Jesus and we're gonna all confess about how we have done that in our lives because we do it all the time. How many of you know somebody on the flip side that every time you're with them, you leave a conversation with them and you realized they hadn't really said anything about who they are, but you spent a whole bunch of time talking about you because they were inquiring about you and you felt loved by them? Raise your hand. It's like they're the person that they're like, oh, there you are. I believe that this is a very simple way of how we can engage ourselves and be mindful when we're in a room of how emotionally mature we're growing. And I want to walk through 5 ways today that we can, and I believe it all comes down to this one phrase, the greatest commandment, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and strength, and the second is like it, love your neighbor as who? Yourself. This really comes back to also that we have to love ourselves. We have to know that we love because he first loved us. It comes back to experiencing the love of God for us, the love of Abba, the love of the Father. So let's talk about 5 ways that we can do that. Number one, it begins by finding safe people. Find safe people. We developed an emotional intelligence curriculum at a school in Nashville that we're piloting this year, and I teach grades 9 through 12. Emotional intelligence each week. I'll be there tomorrow. And I was talking about this phrase, here I am versus oh, there you are. And I had a student raise her hand and she said, Dr. Josh, she said, I have a question. She said, how am I supposed to show up all of the time with oh, there you are? Aren't I supposed to experience, because isn't that going to get lonely? Shouldn't I be sharing my life with somebody? Shouldn't somebody see me at some point? And I said, yes. Can you ask that question? She asked me at the end of class. I said, can you ask that at the beginning of the next class? Here's the reality. We all must experience, here I am, from somebody. Somebody who sits with us in our here I am moments. Because you will have fear. You will be sad. You will be angry. You will be jealous. You will feel embarrassed. You will have all of these feelings in your life. And I want you to think right now who the safe people are who accept you just as you are. They accept you for who you are, and they love you enough to not leave you that way. Let me go there as well. Because sometimes we go, oh, I just want a friend who accepts me as I am. The reality is you should find friends who accept you as you are, but love you enough to not leave you that way. But who are the people in your life? Maybe it's a parent, maybe it's a pastor, maybe it's a coach, maybe it's a teacher, who loves you for who you are, and you know you can be you. You can truly be yourself. You don't have to hide behind grades. You don't have to hide behind your athletics ability. You don't have to hide behind anything. You can just be yourself. How many of you have someone in your life right now that you know right now I can be myself with? Raise your hand. You know right now who that person is. Here's what I want you to do today. I want you to go to that person and I want you to thank them for who they are. I want you to go to that person today. It's a text, it's a phone call. If you see them today, I want you to thank them for who they are. And here's the other reality of this too. I really want to encourage you to find safe people who aren't just your peers. You need peers who are your safe people, but you also need people who are older than you, who've lived life. I'm 42 years old. I have a therapist in my life. I have a coach, a life coach. I have my personal pastors. I have a spiritual director. I have people in my life who I can be myself with because I want to live this stuff. I want to be accountable to people. I want people in my world who I can enter into and who will love me for who I am, but who love me enough to not leave me that way. And so find your safe people. If you do not have someone in your life who is safe for you, I really want to encourage you to talk to, I know you can trust this guy right here, right? Talk to him, talk to a parent, talk to a teacher, talk to somebody who you can say, listen, I need someone. I don't know who I can just be myself with. Or maybe you're afraid to be yourself. I just want to encourage you to step out and have the courage to find someone you can be yourself with and invite them into your life. Which leads to number two, respond more than you react. Respond more than you react. Now, I'm going to go into a little neuroscience for you, a little neuroscience research, and then I'm going to connect it to scripture. So bear with me on this for a second, okay? Ready for neuroscience research? All right, here we go. Your brain grows from the bottom to the top. The bottom part of the brain, back here where the brain meets the brainstem, put your hand on that part of the brain right there. Yep, that's the amygdala, okay? That's your fight, flight, or freeze response. That's the part of your brain that's going off when you feel fear or in danger, okay? Now, the top part of your brain behind the eyes, that's your prefrontal cortex. That's the part of your brain that's known for problem solving. It's known for social skills. It's known for cognitive flexibility, emotion regulation, and self-control, okay? The reason that all of parenting research goes back to emotional safety is because when kids are overwhelmed, when they're feeling fear or stress or anxiety, what ends up happening is we as parents need to be a calm that can calm their brain to trigger the higher functioning parts of the brain to get them to think straight, and it's thinking straight that leads to every major outcome that we desire in our kids. You tracking with me? Okay? So what happens is our ability, because when your fight, flight, or freeze is going off, this part of the brain shuts down. By the way, this part of the brain isn't fully developed in y'all yet. That's why rental car companies are smarter than politicians. You have to be 25 to rent a car and 16 to drive one. This part of the brain doesn't fully develop until you hit about your mid-20s, okay? But you can actually grow it faster by entering into face-to-face relationships, by actually dealing with healthy conflict with one another. I'm going to share something today. I don't really talk about screens that much, but I'm going to share this real quickly. There is no... When you train your brain for face-to-face eye contact in relationships, your brain becomes wired for relationships. When you wire your brain for, when you are on screens, your brain becomes wired for screens. I can honestly tell you, there is no detrimental effect to being on screens less. Okay? I'm just gonna say that. Practice face-to-face eye contact. If you have conflict with a friend, go to that friend, Matthew 18, go to them in person, look them in the eye, and handle the conflict together. If you can't handle it, go to two people. There's a reason that this is biblical. It will wire your brain for healthy relationships. It will wire your brain for success later in life when you have to deal with an employee, when you have to deal with a coach, when you have to deal with a boss, right? Brain shuts down when you're in fear, fight or freeze, the higher functioning parts of the brain, okay? It gets overwhelmed. The brain also grows from the right to the left. Okay, so the right side of your brain is your experiential here and now part of the brain. It's the part of the brain that it's what you're feeling in the moment. It's what you're feeling right now. It's what you're experiencing. You guys just got back from spring break, right? So I want you to think right now of a moment on spring break that you just enjoyed. It was the best moment of spring break. Just go there. All right, I'm starting to see some smiles, right? That's your here and now part of the brain. Like, that's like, I just took you back there. Now I have to bring you back here, okay? Sorry. Come back here now. Come back with me, right? The left side of the brain so this is right side of the brain here and now. Left side of the brain is your linguistic side. It's the part of the brain that puts language to what it is that you're experiencing in the moment. The middle part of the brain is called the corpus callosum. I like to call this the binding of the book because what this is how you wire your brain for relationships by putting language to what it is you experienced. By saying, I'm embarrassed, I'm afraid, I felt rejected, I felt sad, I felt glad, I felt ecstatic, I was surprised, right? Building your emotional vocabulary wires your brain and writes your story. A disintegrated brain, a traumatized brain, is one that has never put language to the experience. The more you put language to your experience, the more you write your story and the more coherent your narrative is. So, We react out of our emotion, out of the emotion side of our brain. The more that we can wire this part and build this part of the brain, the more we can respond. How do we do that? We do that by putting language to what it is we're experiencing. Now, let me go here for a second. I had a dad of a 14-year-old that I was coaching and working with, and he said, Josh, he said, I don't know what to do. He's like, my daughter wants to go to a Friday night football game. I said, okay, let's talk about this a little bit. I said, well, what happened? He said, well, when she came home and asked me to go to the Friday night football game, I told her she couldn't go, and she looked at me and she said, Dad, I hate you. And she went storming to her bedroom. So dad is a little bit overwhelmed, okay? Dad is feeling this, okay? When I talk about emotional safety and the posture of emotional safety, I'm usually talking to parents about this and talking to them about how they respond to this moment. Because guess what that daughter, that 14-year-old, is experiencing? Is she functioning out of her lower part of her brain or the higher part of her brain? The lower part of the brain. She's fight, flight, or freeze. Something happened that triggered emotion in her. Whether it was fear, whether it was embarrassment, whether it was rejection. Do you know what this dad found out about his daughter after she said no? By the way, there's a couple different ways we can handle this as adults. One of those, a posture of emotional safety, because this happens to all of us, by the way. I know you aren't parents yet, but you have friends who will do this to you. You will have friends who will lash out at you and say, I hate you, don't ever do that to me again, don't ever look at me that way. And it's like, how am I supposed to show up with, oh, there you are, in a moment that I'm getting attacked like that, right? The posture of emotional safety isn't going, don't you ever speak to me that way again. I'm taking your phone for a month and no, you're not going to that Friday night football game. Do you understand me? But yet so often as parents, we function out of our own amygdala because we are triggered. And you might do that as a friend. A friend comes to you and they go, I hate you. And all of a sudden you're like, yeah, well, I hate you too. Because you're functioning out of your amygdala, you're not thinking straight. Emotional safety is also not dismissing it and being like, don't be mad at me. Or it's just a Friday night football game, who cares? The posture of emotional safety, and this goes for all of us, is our ability, because we're on both sides of this coin here, guys. There's times we're getting yelled at, and there's times that we're the ones that are doing the yelling. Or we want to do the yelling. We want to react rather than respond. Our ability to, in a moment like that, be able to look at the person and be able to say, what is it about that Friday night football game that matters to you so much? And what the dad found out about his daughter is that she had been rejected by a group of friends that she hung out with the previous school year. She would see them posting pictures on Snapchat and Instagram of them hanging out without her. And this was the first Friday night they invited her to be a part of something, and her dad said no. You see the reaction? Anger. Do you want to know the feeling? Rejection. And now all of a sudden, she was feeling more rejected, more angry, and she was just lashing out. It didn't matter. Listen, you all are that 14-year-old. You all are that 15-year-old, 16-year-old, 13-year-old, however old you are right now. And we have an opportunity to think about, am I showing up with, here I am, you're rejecting me, you're saying no to me, this isn't fair, I have to live under your roof, I have to obey your rules, or you can respond with, Dad, honestly, this football game matters to me so much because I've been rejected by these friends and they invited me and saying no, I'm just afraid of how they're going to see me now. But you see, what ends up happening is we're afraid to go there. We're afraid to get vulnerable. We're afraid to respond rather than react because we don't know how to label our emotions. We don't know how to give our emotions. We don't know how to put language to them because what we're either doing is we're reacting out of them or we're suppressing them. We're denying them. We're pretending they're not there. And the reality is God has a way for us to do this. This isn't just, I think the Apostle Paul understood the brain. The Apostle Paul understood how we are to live this out. Do you know what he said? Look at Philippians chapter 4. Do not be anxious about what? Anything. But in every situation, it doesn't matter what it is, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving. Do you know that neuroscientists have found that anxiety and gratitude cannot coexist in the brain? Great. The more gratitude you have, the more you push fear out of your brain. With thanksgiving, Paul understood all of this. I believe it. with thanksgiving, make your request known to God. Label what it is that you're feeling to God. Voice it aloud to God in prayer, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. You see what happens? We have a Father in heaven who's emotionally safe for us already. He is the safest person in your life. He is the one who will help you walk out into the world and respond rather than react. And do you want to know what Paul did after this? He then writes this. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, anything noble, pure, excellent, or praiseworthy, what does he say? Think on these things. You see, the Apostle Paul didn't write this verse first and then say, be anxious about nothing. I think he wrote this verse after because he realized we don't think straight when we're anxious. So he said, go to your Father, who's the most emotionally safest person for you on the planet. He will calm your brain. He will give you a peace that surpasses all understanding. Then you can respond in how you show up. Because now you all of a sudden, you can think thoughts that are pure and true and lovely and excellent and praiseworthy toward a parent who you now were thinking was against you. And maybe now you enter into your parents' world and go, oh, this is why my parents said no. This is why my mom and dad said no. Our ability to show up and respond rather than to react, we have to meet with the Father. Your identity is grounded there. When your identity is what your friends think of you, you will react. When your identity is grounded in what Abba thinks of you, you will respond. Let's respond and not react. Leads to the next one. Talk about emotions. You can imagine I was going to say this. I used to counsel juvenile delinquents. So juvenile delinquents were court appointed to me and my job was to help them have remorse and feel remorse for their victims. But the reality was, is I couldn't help them feel remorse for their victims. Do you know why? Because nobody had ever felt and accepted them in their pain. I didn't meet one juvenile delinquent who had a great relationship with his dad. Most of them didn't even know who their dad was. And yet no one ever sat with them to meet with them in that pain. And so the very first thing I would do with every juvenile delinquent is I would give him a feelings chart at the beginning of the session, because I wanted him to begin to identify his emotions. Because until he could identify his emotions and be okay sitting with someone who was safe with him, he could never enter into another person's world and experience safety and experience empathy and remorse for that person. Jesus said this, love your neighbor as who? Yourself. We must be able to have compassion for ourselves, but that compassion comes out of first the experience of the love of Abba for us. We love because he first loved us. Proverbs 16:32 says this, patience is better than power, and controlling one's emotions than capturing a city. Look, you can capture a city, you can get your dream job, you can get to the top of whatever ladder it is that you're working for in your field, but if you can't control your emotions, you will lose the city. You will lose the position, because not controlling your emotions means that your emotions control you. And in order to bring them under control, we must be able to talk about them. My wife and I wrote a children's book called What Am I Feeling? And in the back, there's a pull-out feelings chart. And we have our kids label and talk about what it is that they're feeling. And one day, our daughter, who's 7, she came home from being at friend's house, and she was just defiant. She's our sweet little girl. We call her our sweet girl. And she came home, and she was just being defiant. She wasn't listening. It was so frustrating as parents. And what were we doing? We were doing the, don't talk like that. You know better. Go to timeout. Like, we were reacting out of that. You see what I mean? Like, we know better. You have to live this every day, right? Well, at bedtime that night, Christy's tucking Kennedy in the bed, and she said, sweetheart, did something happen? Like, what are you feeling right now? She pulled out the feelings chart, and Kennedy pointed to it, and she said, angry. And then her little finger moved to embarrassed. And my wife looked at her, and she said, sweetie, what happened today? Like, you were not yourself. And Kennedy proceeded to tell her that when we were at our friend's house, she was hanging out with two of her other little friends, and those two friends went into the one friend's bedroom and locked the door and said, Kennedy, we're going to play by ourselves for a little bit. We want you to stay out here. And so our sweet girl didn't have language to talk about how she felt rejected. She was embarrassed, and it was coming out in anger. You see, when we don't label our emotions, a lot of times what ends up happening is it comes out in anger. So when you have a loved one who's angry, think about James 1:19 and 20. I believe James 1:19 and 20 is probably the most sanctifying verses, set of verses in all of Scripture. Do you know what it says? Be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not accomplish God's righteousness. Human anger does not accomplish God's righteousness. And yet so often when we're not doing well, we're slow to listen, we're quick to speak, and we're quick to become angry. And when you see someone in your life doing that, your ability to walk into their world and go, oh, there you are. What's going on? What's really going on? How can I serve you? How can I show up for you? How can I be there for you? Will have a calming effect on their brain and allow them to be able to think straight for the situation. Talk about emotions. By the way, I think there's two, before I move on to my next point, I think there's two things that are happening in our culture today that I think that if you guys can get right, you will be set up for success for the rest of your life. I believe that we are biblically illiterate, and I believe that we are emotionally illiterate. And if you can become biblically literate and emotionally literate, and you can expand your vocabulary of emotions in your life and start identifying them, I believe it's how God speaks to us. I believe he speaks to us through our emotions. But if you do that apart from Scripture, you'll start to act on your emotions. But when you filter it through the lens of Scripture and you become biblically literate, man, those two are a force. And if you can get that right now, I'm telling you, biblically and emotionally literate, you will be set up for life. It leads us to number four, never stop playing. Never stop playing. Do you know who we see? In therapy, most people that I see in therapy are in therapy because they've lost a sense of their inner child. They stopped playing. They forgot who they were in their inner child. There was a guy I was with on Monday. The guy's like in his upper 60s, and he's standing on a stage, and he's speaking to us, and he's got a trombone, and he's just playing Row, Row, Row Your Boat. He's on a little ukulele. I mean, he's 60-some years old, and he's up there being a child. He's a man who has, and he's one of the healthiest, married 47 years. Like, he's one of the healthiest humans that I know, and he has an inner child that is just playful and fun and just beautiful. You know, in Genesis chapter 1, and this is what I want you to kind of see, because we've got to be able to live from a joyful heart, a place of rest. You see, what ends up happening is you start to, when you start to become emotionally immature, is when you start to identify with who you are, with what you do. We start to become emotionally immature the more that we start to identify who we are with who we hang out with. We also start to become emotionally immature by identifying, and this was me, by how much I worked. How much I looked good because I was just busy. I was very productive. I was doing things, right? And I started to lose myself in that. But you see, when you go back to Genesis chapter 1, what you discover is that God designed us in a rhythm. He designed us to have a rhythm where we live from rest and not for rest. You guys are probably... I don't know if you guys would know this. My wife is going to hate me for doing this because she just gets embarrassed when I sing from stage. But you guys ever hear the song, Living for the Weekend? Anybody? Come on. You guys are probably too young, right? We are not living for the weekend. All right. God did not design us to live for the weekend. He designed us to live from rest and not for rest. He created the world in 6 days, and then he rested on the seventh day, not because... He needed rest, and because he was tired, he did it as a gift to us to experience rest. This is why I love working in the Chick-fil-A world, because they understand Sundays, they closed, right? It's like, we are going to rest. We are going to, and in our family, we have a rhythm of practicing the Jewish feast, of having Shabbat on Friday night. And we have our Sabbath on Saturday as a family because Sunday we serve in our church and it's just a busy day. So we practice Sabbath on Saturday, and our kids know that every Friday night we're having a Shabbat meal, and Saturday we are resting and we are playing and we are having fun because we're going to live from rest and not for it. And you want to know what something else about that is, that every single day, go back to Genesis chapter 1. In Genesis chapter 1, what God is doing is he's saying on the first day that he created, he said on day 1 there was evening and then there was morning the first day. And then on the second day, it said there was evening, and then there was morning the second day. Did you know that the Hebrew calendar starts in the evening, not in the morning? Why do you think that is? Think about if you started your day with the most amazing meal of the day, dinner, right? It's like, that's the dinner, that's the meal that you have that's like steak, right? Whatever it is you're having. Like, it's the gourmet meal of the day. And then you have this incredible meal, and then God says, okay, now I want you to go to bed for 8 hours. Starting your day with a meal and then sleep for 8 hours. And by the way, I'm not going to be sleeping, but while you are sleeping, I'm going to be doing some things in your life that I want you to go and carry out to build for the new earth, because we're partnering with Jesus in the new, which is amazing. Like, we're building for his kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. We get to be a part of that. That's what we get to be a part of. And so he says, okay, now that you have rested, I want to meet with you in the cool of the day. Adam and Eve walked with God in the cool day. I want to meet with you in the morning because I want to tell you everything that I've been doing while you've been sleeping, so now you can go in and carry that out for the rest of the 8 hours that you have left of your day. And we end our day with our work rather than... And then God said this at the end of every day. He celebrated. It is good. It is good. It is good. We live from rest and not for rest. What is it that you find in your life that just brings you rest? It's something that you do. It is what you play. It is where you just lose track of time when you're doing it. You just lose track of that because you love it so much. You, whether it's with a friend, whether it's, for me growing up, it was riding my bike to the creek and fishing. And I just lost track of time. So today, one of the things that I always do is I go fishing. We go to the lake almost every weekend that we can in the summer with our kids because I grew up on the lake, my wife grew up on the lake, and we just don't want to ever stop playing. Find the things that bring you alive in your true self with who you are before God and God alone and keep doing them and learn to celebrate. It keeps you showing up in a place where you're, oh, there you are, rather than here I am. And the last one is this. Respond with, oh, there you are, to the one saying, here I am. In Isaiah chapter 65, verse 1, he writes this. The Lord says, I was ready to respond, but no one asked for help. I was ready to be found, but no one was looking for me. I said, here I am, here I am, to a nation that did not call on my name. There is one who is saying, here I am. Whether you're calling on him or not, he is sitting with you saying, here I am. In our busyness so often, in our fears so often, what we do is we run in and out, as we often do, your teenagers, as you often do with your parents. Your parents are saying, hey, just sit with me for a minute. Let's catch up. Let's spend some time. You're like, I got to go to my friend's house. I got to go here. I got to go there, right? And your parents are just like, hey, can I get a minute? Sometimes that's what God does. That's always what God does for us. He's always sitting there saying, here I am, whether we're calling on him or not. And our ability to respond to the one who's saying, hey, here I am, I'm over here, I'm waiting to love you. The more that we respond to his beckoning, to his call, the more able we are to experience his love and enter out into the world, to enter into a room, to enter into class, to enter into wherever we are and go, oh, there you are. Oh, there you are. Because you have an Abba Father who loves you so incredibly much. And so I want to encourage you today. He's waiting for you. He's always there. I want you to get in your mind's eye right now. Just think about when you wake up in the morning, maybe sitting in your living room or sitting in a room somewhere in your house where you're sitting, you're having breakfast. I want you just to imagine that Jesus is sitting in the empty chair right next to you, because he is. And he just wants to have a conversation. He just wants to talk. He wants to share with you. He wants you to be with him in your true self. Because when we live there, when we enter into his presence, what ends up happening is we find ourselves, and we don't have to go chasing in the world around us. We don't have to chase to cover our insecurities because he meets us and he is our security. Father, I thank you, God, for this group of students. Father, I thank you for how much you love us. I thank you for how much you are waiting for us, that you are crying, "Here I am." Help all of us, God, please, to show up with you, to sit with you, to listen to you, so that we can go out into the world with others and see them, to respond, not react, to know what it is that we're going on in our hearts, to play well, to rest well, because we're living in you. Help us to be able to see others and go, "Oh, there you are," because of the way that you've loved us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you all.
Thank you. As usual, Josh will be hanging out down here out front. And the norm is anybody that wants to come by and say thank you or ask a question or a comment or whatever. And y'all know the drill for any teachers. We'll have them hang out for just a sec. If you want to talk to them, that's great. But we want to give students first dibs, please. Hey, our challenge is pretty clear, right? I love that we have chapel right after this because it's such a, or chapel right after this, what am I talking about? Lunch right after this. Y'all are like, double chapel? Yeah, we got to do our makeup chapel from last week. No, we have lunch right after this. It's a perfect opportunity for you guys to actually put into practice what you've been listening to, right? So this is your chance, right, to be a, "Oh, there you are" type of friend rather than a "here I am" type of friend. Y'all are dismissed.
There's honey in the rock, water in the storm.